Welcome back from that short break. My name is Darren Bartlett, and I'm still with Irene Elizabeth Naminga, who is the road safety engineer from KCCA. But before we went to the break, Irene, I asked the question, is that why do we still have potholes in Kampala, even after a very short time, when you have repaired these roads?
Most of our roads in Kampala have overpassed their cycle length, their cycle time. Is that true? They were constructed a very, very long time ago.
But are those that were repaired, like Lugogo here?
Repair is different from construction. When we are constructing a road, we estimate the years it
will take. This will last 100 years?
Not 100. 10, 15, 20. Maximum is 20, but most of them were 15-year. Now, these roads are probably at 25 or 30, and these same roads we have patched. It's like an old dress. You patch here and patch here and patch here.
And patch the same
as road. You're going back here, as you're still here, this one has tore again because it's an old cloth. So our roads are a bit old. But the good news is, we have a project under the African Development Bank that is going to rehabilitate most of the Kampala roads. In that, we have about 260 kilometers of roads that is going to be rehabilitated just in Kampala roads. So I think we are going to see some changes. For example, you said the road, Spring Road?
This one?
Yes, Spring Road. That is one of them. It's going to be rehabilitated. We just have to be patient.
Do we also have a plan to allocate specific roads for specific cars? Why would a truck carrying hundreds of tons of cement use the same road as a sedan car that is not carrying that much? Do we have a plan to say, you know, heavy trucks, then these ones can pass here? That's the same way we have on the Northern Bypass. If you pass in Beogere, you'll see heavy trucks, then other cars can use the top one.
We have a heavy goods vehicle plan with the Ministry of Works, and they're trying to pass that regulation in which heavy goods will be restricted to certain roads and restricted from certain roads, but also to certain times on certain roads. So that plan is underway. We worked on it with the Ministry of Works.
Okay, so I mean, how do we get out from this death trap called crashes in Kampala? If in your expertise and your vision, and how do we get out of it?
Me as Irene or me as KCCA?
Both.
Me as Irene. I sincerely believe that KCCA is doing its very best. It's very best to see that the infrastructure is in place, infrastructure is improved, there are signages that are procured every year, markings are procured every year, you've got talking roads, you've got signals, you've got new roads yearly. But I'll tell you one thing that hasn't changed is the road user behavior. And I insist on it because everything we have done, and I've been a part of everything. And every time I ask my question, why are people still dying? Why is it that people don't get it? Why is it that people can't walk? You'd rather walk than be on a border and die. You've signed no death contract with that guy that he will not get you in a crash. He probably will.
But you see, you can walk and a guy off the road knocks you dead, just like we saw what happened in Akron.
That is true. That is very true. Those are really there, and it's a reality. But that person knocking them is still a road user who is probably over speeding, or is driving under the influence, or is driving a car that is not in good condition. These things are realities. What has not changed is road user. The people in my young age, I remember my father would wake up and check his car, check the bonnet, check the water, you know. Maybe those cars at the time needed that kind of inspection. Maybe. Or maybe the drivers in that time were better trained. Are we still doing the small practices that would make our vehicles good cars, safe cars? Are we looking left, right? Are we stopping at zebra crossings? Everything, no matter how many roads are rehabilitated in Kampala, people will ask for humps, but how many humps are we going to have? People keep saying, put humps, people are over-speeding. The cars don't drive themselves. In Kulambiro, the road is full of humps. But I promise you, I have people complaining. The letters are on my desk, people are complaining that they are people over-speeding. There's a reality problem of behavior.
What forms the decision? Because when you talk about over-speeding, humps and all the things, I've remembered one thing, that there are some places where there were roundabouts and they were removed for it to be kind of like a junction or a cross-through roads, something like that. What informs such a decision? Because one would think that if there was a roundabout, it would automatically slow people who are road users, and then they would, you know, take off other directions. Just this road here at Centenary Park, see how boda bodas cross through even when their lights are red. It's just a mess. They just go. If you're on a boda, I've used a boda in that junction, and I can tell you it's one of the most frightening things ever to be on that road, on a boda. Because there used to be, I think, a roundabout in that place.
What informs the decision is the traffic. As traffic increases, roundabouts are no longer efficient ways. So you must come away from the roundabout into signals. Signals are efficient ways of handling traffic at a junction if the traffic numbers are high. So what informs that decision is the traffic. The car population in Uganda has grown. Where there are roundabouts, remember Chisasi Road?
Yeah.
There used to be a roundabout there, but you would queue. Not necessarily, because you could have been going to Nalia, you could have been going to Chanja, you could have been going maybe back to Chebando. Some of the queues are unnecessary, and that is what traffic signals give you. They're able to separate the traffic. If you're turning left, if you're turning right, if you're going through, you're able to continue your journey without unnecessary queues. So what informs that decision is the traffic. The population has grown. You have approximately 42 million people in Uganda.
Okay.
Of which 4.2 are in Kampala by day, approximately.
As a well-traveled lady, is there any research from wherever you've been, and how do they do it? And if we've seen what they have done, how do we implement what they have done here? Is it possible?
Yeah, it's possible. People have embraced public transport. Developed countries have embraced public transport because public transport moves us away from individual vehicles.
Okay.
Where a vehicle that carries 60 people, you have 60 cars on the road. So why not automatically reduce the number of vehicles by having public transport available? What needs to change is our public transport system. We do have the 14-seaters and the boda bodas, but they are not efficient ways of carrying people. We need mass transit. The passenger rail, have you ever been on that passenger rail? That one?
Yes, from here to, what is the place, after where you get it?
Yes.
Namanvi.
Yeah. The time it takes is so short. I was surprised. The time I used it, I was very surprised, impressed, because it takes a very short time. There's no one going into the railway line, no. No one's going to be conflicting with it, no. So it takes a very short time. You know that if I leave this place, what time does it leave? 5:30?
They start from 5 to 7.
They leave at 5:30, yes? So if you're leaving at 5:30, you know that you'll be in Namanvi at the time they say you'll be in Namanvi. Public transport. Most people efficiently and regularly, the timetables are known, everything is known, the schedule is known. So we must embrace public transport and move away from each one of us owning a vehicle or moving in their own vehicle. The comfort that we believe that is in private vehicles, or other people even find private vehicles are not comfortable, they want to use motorcycles. So the comfort in using individual vehicles actually causes the crashes, is a leading cause of the crashes. We must embrace public transport and improve our public transport systems. That way, we shall be halfway there. Because now, rather than talk to 60 people, I'm going to talk to one bus driver. I'm going to do their medical check. I'm going to ensure that they are penalized if they do something.
Mm-hmm.
It's so easy to penalize one person than 60 people. I don't know if you're starting to see the logic.
I see the logic you're saying. And my follow-up question then would be, are you working towards that as
yes.
an authority?
Yes.
So what happens here? If you implemented part of that research, say public transport within Kampala, what happens here? Do you send out taxis out of Kampala?
I thought you were going to ask me how does it improve.
How? No, you mentioned it. You already said it.
Yeah.
I'm lucky to have seen something
or
happen.
Or what other public transport modes are you thinking about?
No.
You already know them?
Yes. Do you see... What I want to see whether this is possible to be implemented in Kampala as it is. Maputo is one of the cities where when you enter Maputo, you pay. So it discourages a number of cars to enter the city. If you forget something and go out, you come back, you pay. So people decide to park cars outside the city because it's expensive. And it's one of the ways that it has worked for them. And that's why I'm saying for the cities that you've gone to and you've seen it with that research that you probably made, is it really possible to implement it here?
Yes, nothing is impossible. Now, we wouldn't chase away the taxi people or the motorcyclists. We've got a paratransit study that we have been doing, under which we have engaged the taxi operators
mm-hmm.
and the motorcycle operators or the boda-boda operators. The easiest way is to engage them and incorporate them into the same system that you would be working on. So that is what we have done. We've engaged them. Some of them even traveled South Africa and seen the mass transit vehicles that we talk about, the scheduling, that you no longer have a driver going 24 hours.
As long as they drop someone, they pass by.
No, they have shifts. They are driving in shifts. So each one of them can get a turn to drive. Each one of them has a time and a schedule that they're going to drive. So where you would have one driver, now you have maybe five drivers in a day operating the same vehicle. I don't know if you see that. Mass Transit offers options where you can engage them and incorporate them. So we've spoken to them. They're organizing themselves. They're regrouping, really, to be able to fit within the plans of the city. We cannot chase them. When you say chase them, you think KCC is there to chase people? KCC doesn't chase people. We engage them.
Of no borders past this point. If you remember when we were just coming out of COVID, there was this whole plan. Taxis are going to pass here. If you're going to this route, this is where you have to pass. Cars from this place. There was that whole design that was even put in the papers here.
Yeah.
Was it ever implemented? And what is the success?
Some of the things we want to do have forces bigger than ourselves. Doesn't make them bad plans.
Mm-hmm.
The route charts that we give the taxi people were to reduce on congestion on only certain roads.
Certain routes.
Mm. Yes, certain roads. Yet someone can take an alternative route. Yes. Do I believe it would have worked? Yes, I believe it would have worked. Because if you had a proper public transport system, you wouldn't have a bus that is going to, for example, where can we say?
If a bus is going, say, from Boyogerere to Ntinda, no, to, what is that, Wandege, or where you say?
You wouldn't have a bus that is going to Boyogerere, yes, that is supposed to stick on the route of Jinja Road, now diverting at Spear to pass Ntinda because they assume there's no traffic. These passengers are on this route. Some of them are going to get off on this route. So what happens to them? You're going to ask them, I'm turning off, get off. Have you ever used taxis in your life?
Yeah.
Where they tell you, as we are taking this route, get off.
Mm.
Then you now begin to say, but you've already paid you the money. But then you have to get off. My point is, there are dedicated routes for every vehicle. every public transport vehicle. Now, would it have worked? Yes, it should have worked. There are forces that are definitely much stronger than us technical people. Doesn't mean that we don't work. We do work. We propose these ideas that we believe that can temporarily or give us some kind of solution or relief to what we are going through. What we do need is sometimes political support and political will to see them through, or political championship to understand what we are trying to implement.
An interesting one, because I was very much optimistic that that route chart was going to work. I mean, for people who have been through Kenya, they know they use stage numbers. If you don't know yours, then you're going to get lost. So you just have to know number 29 is going to Y's. That's it.
That's it.
Then it avoids this whole, congestion here. But going back to, crashes, that was a plan that I needed to understand, so that people don't find themselves in places where it's inevitable for them to use a border, and then eventually they get into accidents, things like that.
The place of no border, by the way, you asked me no border, yeah? Really?
It's just...
It's right there at Kitgum.
Thank you.
Yes?
I thought you were going to say you're not. I was just going to tell you it's there.
It's there at Kitgum. And from City Square, yeah? From City Square to Kitgum House is about 1.6 kilometers. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that's walkable?
Yeah.
Have you ever attempted to walk?
Yeah.
No. Most people would jump on a border. But it's healthy to walk. It's healthy to walk. Who takes care of the pollution? The children in the cancer ward, have you ever been there?
Yeah.
Have you seen the numbers?
Yeah.
Is it okay?
No, it's not.
How do you think it happens?
Different reasons that cause accidents.
No.
Some of them careless driving.
Pollution. Air pollution. You inhale gases that change the genotype of your baby. Did you know that?
Yeah.
As pregnant women, that happens. You have children with respiratory issues, born with respiratory issues. They've barely lived on this world. Why? No one is looking at the pollution that we are causing with the vehicles. We continuously buy vehicles, enter into these vehicles, drive into the city that is already highly populated. So you have people that are walking, innocent people, low-income earners, walking, and continuously are subjected to pollution. These things, they look like they're from heaven, but they're not from heaven. We need to be looking at the different aspects. What are the consequences of high motorization, and how do we begin to reverse high motorization? Especially in highly populated areas. That area is highly populated. Offices, businesses, they're all in that area. So yes, would a border free zone reduce, or should it have reduced on the pollution? Yes. Should they even restrict vehicles? Yes. Because from City Square to Kitgu is about 1.6 kilometers. From City Square to Wandegea is about 1.6 kilometers. Those are walkable distances. People walk these distances every day in other countries, 10 kilometers, 20 kilometers. People walk them. They are healthier. People who walk are much healthier. They're not battling with hypertension, diabetes, no, because they're burning the food they eat. We are not. We are headed to where they're coming from. These developed countries, they give us the old cars. Why? They have low emission zones in their cities. Low emission zones. Where your car, if it's not of a new model, my friend, it doesn't enter certain areas. We are heading, and then you ship an old car to Africa, where we do nothing, when we have a cancer ward of children, full of children.
With respiratory issues.
And before I go to respiratory issues, these things are happening right before our eyes. Somebody has to really look at it. If motorization is causing this, If transportation is causing this, we need to find ways to start reversing what we are doing to our environment before we go into the other issues. What else that does air pollution do? Before we even go into that, we have air monitors. Did you know? Kesia has air monitors.
Yeah.
They're always red. Red. They are only a bit yellow when there are no cars in the city. We must ask ourselves these questions. If you're doing all these things, why are you doing them? You have data. Are we using it? Whereas it looks like we are chasing people. We are not chasing them. We are encouraging people to live healthier lives, but also to give them a healthier environment. Sadly.
But I wanted to bring you back on infrastructure, if you don't mind. One of the causes of accidents that is ignored is actually the size of the roads. That a car has to compete with other cars in spaces they're not supposed to probably use, or border guys because they don't have riding spaces on narrow roads, and yet the same roads are being used as parking lots. So they leave the road very narrow. Do you have plans to expand these roads, or finding a way of regulating and say this is going to be a one way?
I cannot speak about regulating and making them one ways. I can simply...
Does the authority have that power to change some roads into one ways?
Yes, they can write to the ministry
And advise.
And yes.
Okay.
But do I believe that widening roads is a traffic solution or a congestion solution? No.
Why?
People will buy more cars and fill that road. Have you ever seen those cities that have a 16-lane?
Yes.
And they are filled up in traffic congestion?
Yeah.
You've seen it before?
Yeah.
Isn't it ridiculous that they have 16 lanes and they are still stuck in traffic? We answered this a long time ago. The solution to congestion is public transport. We must answer public transport. That's the solution. Anyway, that's my opinion. We must answer public transport. We must invest heavily, because there are heavy investments in our public transport. Once we answer that solution, once we have different public transport systems, we are going to reduce the congestion in Kampala. If you have the BRT, you have the passenger rail, you have a city bus system, people are going to jump onto these buses. I don't need to come with my car into the city. I am one person. Meanwhile, one person, my spouse has a car also, going in another direction. It is not necessary.
So does the authority, can the authority actually put these facilities in place? You have a tram, can they buy buses to work within the city? Can they put, what did you call it, the rails in the city? Can the authority do that infrastructure in Kampala?
I think you need to ask, do we have the funds?
Do you have the funds?
No. Sorry.
But even if you had the funds, do you have the space to put those things?
Yes. You can reorganize the space you have. The space we have is enough. It can be reorganized to fit public transport. Yes. Because once you have a good public transport system, you no longer need private vehicles. You don't need as many. There will be people who will insist on their private vehicles. There will be there. But the most developed countries, the rich, use public transport. They use public transport. Why? That is the solution. That is the solution to movement. Move people more than you move cars. Reorganize what we have to move people, not to move more vehicles. Even if you broke all those buildings on Kampala Road, it will not reduce the congestion. That one I assure you. Once you provide, for example, BRT or buses that are along those routes that are efficient, scheduled, regular, clean, basic comfort. And these are going to the, for example, you have one maybe going to Woyogere, you have one maybe going to Ntinda, you have one going to Nalia. Oh, please, dear Lord, one goes going to Chira. We don't need to come with our vehicles. We just need to get onto the public transport system. That's all.
Thank you so much, Madam Irene. But I'll just give you 1 minute. You give my my audience, some tips on how to use these words before we wind up.
Tips.
2, 3.
Okay. If you're in a border, please wear a helmet. If you're a rider, wear a helmet. If you're a passenger, wear a helmet, because at least you will save your head. We shall start from there when you've saved your head. So that is the first one. Secondly, let's not rush. Let's slow down. There are speed limits. 30 means don't drive beyond the speed limit of 30. There are school children that are crossing the road or playing in the road. Let's allow that these things, we are human. So let's reduce our speed, follow the speed limits, follow the road signages, wear helmets, but most importantly, protect the vulnerable users. Mm-hmm. Vulnerable users are children, people with disabilities. There are people that are lame. Don't knock them off the road. If you're in a car, unfortunately, if you're in a car, I know people don't like to hear this, but a boda is a vulnerable user to you. Their body is their protection while you have a car. So if you're in a car, protect the boda the boda rider. If you're on a boda, protect the cyclist, the bicyclist, because they are actually in a more vulnerable state than you. If you're in a moving object, protect the people that are walking. If you're in a bus, protect the private, the small standard car. If you're in a truck, protect the one who is in any way smaller than you. So the basic concept, the bigger one protects the smaller one. That is how to know that the other person is more vulnerable than you.
Yeah.
So let's protect the vulnerable users in whatever capacity we are in. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Irene. Thank you guys for tuning in to Urban here, and we want to say that's been a lovely conversation. You need to pick out something. One thing that I have learned even from the what she says, that the only intelligent road user is you, because you're the one who now takes care of the rest on the road. Otherwise, if you don't pay attention to the rest, increase your volume in the car and all these things, you don't hear what, you don't pay attention to the roads, you're going to cause more crashes on the roads. My name is Darren Bartlett, and I'll say have a lovely time.